So you may know that I actually gave another talk earlier today, and that talk was introducing a lot of the technical background that I'm not going to be talking about today. But I'd be happy to discuss it with you or point you towards tutorials and things that will help teach that those details. But what I want to do today is really focus on how we can take those techniques that I talked about this morning and begin to get new kinds of understandings of what cognition is. Are there new kinds of models we can build if we have tools that let us take neurons and build really large-scale models where we can control what the function is that's being controlled by these models? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with just sort of letting you know what direction we're coming from building these models of cognition, and then I'll show you something more specific that actually deals with cognition. So some recent history, as Pierre mentioned, we wrote a book. This book was called Neural Engineering, and in a way, the diagram on the front tells the story about what we're trying to do in this book. We're trying to take high-level descriptions, which are written typically in a dynamical systems kind of language or a control theory kind of language, and then build networks of neurons that are going to realize the dynamics that we described at this higher level. So the real challenge here is how do we connect a bunch of neurons so they're going to perform some interesting function or have some interesting dynamics, presumably one which we've actually seen in brains. So we have a lot of examples in here, but really we don't have anything that would count as cognition. And so in more recent times, what I've done is take the same sort of approach and see, can we extend it to begin to address human cognition, so build cognitive models. So the methods that we have described in here, we actually call the neural engineering framework in the title of the book. And the basic purpose is if you can provide us with a description of an information processing task, and we have some knowledge of what the underlying neurons are like that realize that task. So this might be information about postsynaptic currents, about neurotransmitters that use the part of the brain that are performing this task, about the tuning curves of the neurons, and so on. So if we have some information about the wetware, then what we're going to do is produce a neural mechanism that is going to realize that information processing task using that wetware. So this is useful because a lot of the measurements that we can actually make on brains are measurements of the wetware, right? And it's really those measurements that we're using to guess what the information processing task is. So if we build a model that has a mechanism that we think maps directly into the same sorts of parameters that we're measuring from the system, it becomes fairly straightforward to compare our model to our data, right? Ultimately, this is going to be a process, bootstrapping kind of process. We'll take a guess at the information processing task, and we'll have some data. And then it's going to give us a neural mechanism which will make predictions about new data. We'll gather that data. It will fail, likely. So we'll go and change our information processing task, right? Or we can update our wetware description, do it again, hopefully honing in on what seems to be a very good description of what's going on in a particular part of the brain. The other thing I want to emphasize here is that the kinds of models we're interested in are mechanistic models. So these have to be models that are in some way equivalent to reproducing the mechanisms that are in the brain. So we don't want statistical models, because those models are really good for summarizing data, but they don't give us certain kinds of interventions in the system. With a mechanistic model, we can go and destroy part of the network and make predictions about what's going to happen. Or we can inject extra current, or we can manipulate the neurotransmitters and so on. In a statistical model, you can't have those sorts of interventions. So mechanisms are going to be very important for what we're trying to do. So after positing this theory, we took ourselves seriously, right? And so taking ourselves seriously means that we want to see if this can apply to lots of different circumstances. And so we applied it to lots of different circumstances. We've done motor models, sensory models. I've got here cognitive models, but you'll notice there's no linguistic processing here, right? So when you're in neuroscience, cognition becomes a little easy, as in things like working memory counts cognition, even though by many accounts they probably wouldn't. Things like the effects of emotions on decision making, and so on. So that's the sort of extent of cognition. What I'm going to talk about today is how can we scale this up to human-like cognition, that is the kind of cognition that is unique to humans, namely doing things like language processing, constructing large, sophisticated representations of the world that we then manipulate, and so on. So that's what I'm going to focus on. So this is sort of, you know, the first step towards cognition. And then, of course, given these sorts of principles, we can learn lots of very general things about the brain. And so this sort of provided us a method of getting some theoretical insights into the kinds of patterns that you see replicated over and over when you look through not only mammals, but even non-mammalian brains. So this is sort of an easy way to summarize that work. And what I'm going to do today is just focus on the part where we're interested in language-based reasoning. This morning I focused on something very different, on eye control, because it's a much simpler model, so that's an easy place to describe the technical background. But today I'm going to try to see how far can we push our understanding of how brains work in order to see if we can begin to do something that looks really sophisticated, something at least kind of like human cognition. So one question that might come to you, or maybe not, but has definitely been posed to me, is, well, why bother? Right? Why bother just adding all this complexity and putting a whole bunch of neurons in our models when we're trying to build a cognitive model, right? Where some people think, in fact, all you need is a cognitive description, and what the neurons are doing aren't of interest. Right? So Fodor is famously, and Volition both famously held this kind of view. But I think there's lots of good reasons for neurons. So here are some. One important one is that it gives us contact with a lot more data. One thing that's clearly been happening in psychology is that it's becoming more neural, right? So we have cognitive neuropsychology. And the reason it's becoming more neural is because we have lots of new techniques for gathering data that we didn't have before. All of these kinds of measurements are measurements that we should be able to extract from a neural model that might not come from a non-neural model, because these are measurements of neural properties, right? Even if they're sort of high scales, things like local field potentials or fMRI, there's still filters that are basically applied to underlying spiking patterns or changes in voltage and so on. What else might we, why else might we want neurons in our models? I'm going to give an example of this, and that is basically we might get explanations for assumptions that we have built into cognitive models now. So for those of you who are familiar with a lot of the sort of recent work on cognitive modeling, one thing that they typically have is the 50 millisecond time step for choosing in production. So they call this when a production fires, it takes about 50 milliseconds. Now, why 50 milliseconds? The answer right now is that 50 milliseconds because it fits the data. Right? So if you choose a time step of 50 milliseconds, you can actually make predictions about lots of different reaction times across a lot of tasks. But the question is, well, why 50 milliseconds? Right? Other than data fitting, is there something intrinsic to the system that can explain why we have that particular number? And so I think in this case, we can give a potential explanation, and that's the sort of thing that we might be able to get in general when we turn to neurons. Similarly, why are some of these sort of cognitive features, like productivity, systematicity, and so on, not really ideal, right? So if we look at real cognitive systems, they're not perfectly productive. They're not perfectly systematic, and so on. Can we get explanations for why productivity and so on are limited in virtue of looking at the implementational constraints that are imposed by the fact that the system is realized in neurons? With neurons, we also have a wider range of manipulations of our models, right? So we can look at the effects of brain damage. We can predict the effects of brain damage because our models are supposed to be structured in the same sort of way the brain is. If our model stops at a cognitive description, that might not be the case. Similarly, we can look at the effects of things like genetic alteration, degeneration of parts of the brain, right? Make predictions about how cognition is going to change when parts of the brain begin to atrophy and so on. What are the effects of stimulation? Right? So if you have a model in which you have neurons, you can go and stimulate those neurons, you can destroy the neurons, you can manipulate them in various ways. And so it's going to give us a lot more predictions, basically, than we get of our model than if we did not have neurons. And maybe there are others, right? So one that has been suggested is learning. That is, like, biologically plausible learning is going to be specific and unique to what you can do with neurons, and might not be the kind of thing that can be reflected at a higher level in the cognitive model. Okay, so hopefully at least one of those reasons strikes you as a good reason to turn to neurons. Now, the question that happens if we accept the notion that we want to turn to neurons, what kinds of challenges are we going to run into? Right. So the nice thing about cognitive modeling using traditional methods is that the level of description in the model matches well the level of description of the phenomenon we're interested in. Right, so we can write sentences down and think about how the internal language is manipulated in order to explain various kinds of behaviors. But if we're turning to neurons, we now have to sort of get rid of those. Right? We no longer have our symbols already. We have to do something with neurons that is going to somehow act like a symbol, right, and explain that linguistic process. So in order to do that, we run into a lot of challenges, right? And these are often challenges of scale. We're going to have to make our models really big before we can do anything that looks vaguely like language processing. So in particular, I've identified four problems, or four challenges. And what I'm going to do through the rest of the talk is basically tell you how we address each of these challenges. So the first challenge is going to be, how do we have structured representations in biologically realistic neurons? Right? So this is perhaps the most obvious challenge. That is, if we want to explain language processing, how do we represent the kinds of complex structures you can represent with language when all we have are a bunch of neurons? This is a problem that has been presented to connectionists in general by Fodor and Polishin in 88, and again by Yakundov in 2003 in his recent book. Those are basically exercises in saying, if you turn to neurons, you're going to not be able to have systematicity or productivity, anything like you see in cognitive systems. So here's the question, right? How are we going to solve those problems to the extent that they really are reflected in cognition? I'm going to suggest a solution to this, but in order to realize the solution, we're going to run into another problem, and that is namely that we're going to have to do processing in very high-dimensional vectors, and we're going to have to be able to do nonlinear computations, and we have to do both of those with neurons. Right? So we've restricted ourselves to using neurons, so the question is, how can we do these sorts of things which are demanded by implementing a structured representation? The third challenge is to build the kinds of components that we expect to find in a cognitive architecture. I'll give two examples. One is a buffer. So a buffer is a kind of working memory that can be updated in time. This is probably the most common component of any cognitive architecture you're running into. And so I'll describe how we can implement that. Another one is cleanup memory. So this is a kind of associative memory. This is also another very common sort of architectural component that you'll run into. So with those two examples in hand, I'll move to the last challenge, which is to build large-scale complex neural circuits. So basically, how do we take all these components, which are doing nonlinear computations with many neurons, and put them together in such a way that there is some interesting function coming out at the end? So this is essentially my plan for the rest of the talk. And I should mention at this point that I'm happy to take questions as I go on to try to clarify something, and if the question becomes too in-depth, then we can close it. Okay, so the first challenge, how do we represent structure with a bunch of neurons? And what I'm going to do is take advantage of one of the ways that we have introduced of thinking about what neural systems are doing in our neural engineering framework. And this is to draw a distinction between the representations at the level of single neurons, so I'll call this basic level representation or neural representation, and what those neurons can be taken to represent at a higher level. Right, so I'll call this a systems level representation. The simplest example of something like this I'll take from what I was talking about earlier this morning, and that is, we can take the example of representing the eye position, horizontal eye position. So this is something that is represented in neurons, in goldfish, or in humans. It's a very common part of the brain. And what we find there is that there are many neurons that are sensitive to the position of your eye. And so in the goldfish it's about 40, and in humans it's about 2,000. So if we look at the goldfish and we change the eye position, right? So this is a low-dimensional representation, it's only a scalar. We see that 100 neurons have their, or rather 40 neurons have their activities changed as we move through eye positions. So when I'm talking about neural representation, I'll be talking about the actual activity of the neurons. And when I'm talking about system-level representation, I'll be talking about the thing they're representing, which would be something like eye position. Okay, so typically, these things like eye position, system-level vectors, or the system-level representations are much lower dimensional than thinking about all the neurons at the same time. So in order to solve this problem of structured representations, what I'm going to do is introduce a solution at the systems level, right, and then embed it into neurons where we can know that we're going to be able to implement the kinds of functions we need to realize this solution. So what the framework lets us do is essentially do vector processing, right? So if we have a solution to a problem that we can write down as transformations of vectors, then we know we have a method for realizing that solution in neurons. Okay, so what I'm going to do is present a solution that is vector processing. So in fact, there have been a lot of solutions to the problem of structured representation using vectors. Here are four. Perhaps the first one was Smolensky's tensor products. Another is Kinnear's spatter codes. So tensor products is using a particular kind of multiplication. Kinnear's spatter codes is using the same sort of multiplication but doing it with binary vectors. Gaylor has another solution where he has a different kind of multiplication than the other ones. And a fellow by the name of Tony Plate introduced something called HRRs, or holographic reduced representations, which has a yet another kind of multiplication. So instead of talking about each one of these individually, I'll just talk about these as vector symbolic architectures. And they have a few things in common. So they always identify three different operations. One is a binding operation, which is typically multiplication. A second is a composing operation, which is typically superposition or addition. And the last is sometimes called a hide operation, or something that protects a bound set of vectors from other vectors. Right? It's a way of not letting vectors get confused when you bind them together. Now, I obviously haven't told you what these are. And the reason is because each of the different VSAs I mentioned actually gives you a slightly different operator. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to choose a particular VSA, in particular this one, HRRs, which was the last one I used before. And I'm going to tell you how, for that particular VSA, we can build structured representations. And if for some reason you have another preferred VSA, then you can determine the solution by analogy. The reason we've chosen HRRs is for the following reasons. One is that the vectors always stay the same length. So what we're going to essentially do is have a really high dimensional vector and figure out a way of manipulating this vector to act like a structured representation. The nice thing about HRRs is no matter how complex the structure gets, the length of the vector stays the same. Right, so this is something that is useful for building neural models. Another is that we can actually get rid of essentially one of these operators. Namely, the bind operator automatically protects things. So this is nice because it makes life simpler. Right? We only have to implement one of the operators instead of two. And lastly, unlike the spatter codes, HRRs are real value. And there's pretty good evidence that neurons are very good at representing real value numbers. So we might as well take advantage of the fact that they can represent a continuum of numbers, or approximate a continuum of numbers, rather than just having binary values. OK, so how do, or what are these operations in this particular vector symbolic architecture? HRRs. So the first is called circular convolution, and this you can just think of as a binding operator. This is the technical definition, but I'm happy to think about A and B as being multiplied when we see this cross with a circle around it. The sort of intuitive way to think of what's going on is you're taking two high-dimensional vectors that have the same number of dimensions, and you're interweaving them. Right? So convolution is another sort of word for twisting. And so you can think that what we're doing is, you know, each one of these strands is a vector that we're starting with, and when we bind them together using this operator, we're interweaving them to give us another vector of the same number of dimensions, which somehow includes the information that was carried in those previous two vectors. Okay, so it's an operation which is binding the two vectors that we started with, A and B, into another vector, which we're going to call C. Now, of course, if you bind things, you also have to unbind them. So we might want to know what B was. Right, when all we had is C. So here we can define another operator. Conveniently, that other operator can actually be defined in terms of the first operator. Right. So binding and unbinding basically become the same operator, and all you have to do is do an inverse on the vector that you want to unbind, or the companion of the vector you want to unbind. So in terms of the rope, right, if this is vector A and this is vector B, right, we can bind them, and this gives us C, just the whole rope. And then if we want to get B out, we can take the inverse of A, bind it again, and we'll get B out. Right? So it's this thing that lets us basically construct and deconstruct operators which either have bound or unbound components.
I'm sorry. Does A and B represent vectors, space, neural states, or so, something? So what do they?
So eventually, those vectors will be encoded by neural space. Yeah. Yep.
But for the inverse operation, you had approximately equal.
Yeah.
Does it mean that you do you keep the norm? Is the norm intact?
Is the norm no? The norm will not is not guaranteed to be intact.
Okay.
But the direction is.
Okay.
Yeah. So typically you renormalize. But in fact you also lose direction information. So the approximately equal is important.
Okay.
And I will come back to that for sure. Yeah. Yes. So I mean, what's the reason you sacrifice? You make a sacrifice and you want the approximate equals because then you don't have to change dimensions. Otherwise, you have to change dimensions if you want to store all the information from both vectors. Okay, so, I mean, right now, what I've talked about in terms of these VSAs has been very abstract. So, what I'm going to do is try to give you a specific example. So suppose we want our system to be able to represent and manipulate a rule, right? And we might see the rule as being something like this. So this is the rule itself is abstract, but it's much more concrete than what I've been talking about so far. So we might have a rule like this. If there is a vowel, right? So this comes from the waste and card task. So in the waste and card task, you're presented four cards. On one side of the card is a letter, and on the other side is a number. And so one of the rules that you might be given to determine if it's true of these cards is something like this. If there's a vowel on one side of those cards, then there is an even number on the other side of the card. Now the question is, we're not interested in the task right now, how would we represent that rule with vectors using these binding operations and the superposition operations? So this would be sort of a natural way to do it. Right. In a non-neural implementation, or one where we don't care about vectors, we might write down something like if open bracket vowel comma even close bracket. Right? So this would be maybe a Lisp-like implementation. But here we want to do it with vectors because we know how to process vectors with neurons. Okay, so we've introduced operators that are going to let us represent that structure. So here what I've done is I said vowel is the antecedent. So I have this representation where I've got an antecedent. And that antecedent is vowel. So I bound antecedent and vowel together. The relation between antecedent and consequent is implication. So I'm going to say the relation is implication. I bind those two things together. And then I say at the end that the consequent is even. Right? So I bind those two things together. And then I sum them up. And I'm going to have this vector R, which is now my representation of the rule. Okay, so I'm using the multiplication to bind objects to their place in the grammar, if you want. Right? So this is telling us what the value of the variable antecedent is, right? This tells us what the value of the variable relation is, and this tells us what the value of the variable consequent is. And of course, you can change those things around as you get different sorts of rules and so on. And the structures will change as you get more complicated structures. And then you sum these things, and now we have this one vector, which is the same dimensionality of each of the input vectors, and we are going to treat it as encoding that information, right? So it's structured representation. So we can now ask this question, sir. Yeah?
What does the plus stand for?
What does what stand for?
The plus sign.
Is that superposition?
Addition, yeah. Superposition. Vector addition. Yeah. Yeah, so when you do vector addition, you're going to basically blur these things together, right?
Yeah, but how do you unblur them?
So how do you unblur them? You unblur them in the same way that you get rid of the approximately equal to sign. And that's, so remember the component that I said I'm going to tell you about later? It's called a cleanup memory. The cleanup memory is the thing that lets you do unblurring.
The three parts that you add, are they orthogonal? Are they in different dimensions?
They're likely orthogonal, yeah.
Okay.
So, I mean, we're taking advantage of high dimensionality, like the properties of high dimensional vector spaces. Those properties are, well, so, and property of binding. So, property of binding is that if you bind these two things together, the result is going to be orthogonal to both of the things that went into it. Okay, so it automatically won't get confused with either of the things that you put into it. Also in a high-dimensional space, if you add stuff up, then if the space is high-dimensional enough, it's easy to tell those things apart. Right,
so then this is really orthogonal. That's why the plus keeps them separate.
That's why, yeah, so the plus blurs them, it blurs them more than the binding does, right? But, yeah, so it doesn't. The result of adding two vectors together is going to look more like the mean of the two vectors, and the result of binding them is going to look like something that's orthogonal to the two vectors. So it's not as good at keeping the vectors independent as the binding sign. But if you're in a high dimensional enough space, you can actually add quite a few things together before they're blurred so badly you can't recognize them with a cleanup memory.
Okay. But you're making a strong assumption about the dimensionality of the space.
Well, so I haven't said anything about the dimensionality of the space.
What I'm saying,
but that's going to be important in determining how well the system can behave. Absolutely. And I think that's actually one way that we can match cognitive data better. Because people also can't encode arbitrarily complex structures. Yeah. Okay, so if we have something represented in this way, we can begin to sort of ask questions of the system, right? We can say, well, what's the antecedent in that representation? So this is equivalent to saying, what is the thing that is bound in the antecedent position? So in order to do that, we can take, basically we're trying to unbind what's in the antecedent position. And if you remember from the previous slide, to unbind, we take the inverse of the thing that was bound and multiply it by the thing that it's bound into. So if we take this inverse and multiply it by here, by R, this is our representation, we'll get this times this. These are inverses, right? So that's going to be equal to vowel. And then we have this times this. And as I told you before, the binding is going to make the result of the binding orthogonal to the thing you're binding with. So it's actually going to just look like a little bit of noise. Right? It's going to be going off in some other space. And then this times this, same thing. It's going to go off in some other direction of space. So when you perform this binding, essentially what's going to fall out is vowel, right? The result is going to be approximately equal to vowel. So this is nice to know that we can basically unbind. We can find the things that we stuck into our representation. Right? So we can say, what's the MC? We could ask what the relationship is, what the consequent is, all by picking the appropriate part of speech, right, if you will, or the part of the structure, and just binding it with the representation. We might want to do something more sophisticated. We might want to basically perform a transformation on our rule. Maybe the researcher says to us, oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean vowel, I meant consonant, right? So it's really the consonant that's supposed to be the antecedent, the consequence stays the same. Sorry, consonant, I said that. So make the antecedent into a consonant instead of a vowel, and the consequence stays the same. So this is slightly more sophisticated, more complicated, but basically what we're asking is we're saying, take the result, right, that currently is sitting in the antecedent position, and turn it into this other vector, consonant. So here we've got the same operation that we performed up here, right? So this is going to give us the answer vowel. So then we take the opposite of vowel, right? So this is the prime, we're taking the inverse of prime of vowel, multiplying it by consonant, and then multiplying that whole thing into R. If we do that, right? So this is now consonant times vowel prime. So we take consonant times vowel prime, we get vowel prime times vowel, those go to 1 because they're inverses, and we end up with antecedent times consonant, and everything else. Right? The rest of the stuff is going to be preserved. No.
You exceeded my working root of SE. I'm sure that other people must feel like this.
So, regardless of whether you...
antecedent in the middle was worked.
So this part is just this, right? Which is vowel.
Yeah, what I'm missing is make the antecedent into consonant. That is, if the antecedent is a consonant. So if I see a consonant on one side of the car, okay? Because up to there I could see that if I see a vowel, because NT was vowel, I guess by some the answer was word implication even. And at this level, if antecedent was vowel,
right.
Because the ANS itself means you just remove the first term of the addition of treating, and therefore answer is just rel operation implied plus consequence operation even. Was that?
So these.
Or
so
was I? No, just from the top.
Yeah.
No. Yeah.
Here.
At that point. So, if I just calculate anti inverse.
Yes.
Okay. So it was providing vowel plus
noise
plus even.
Yes. Well, those are just noise.
Plus noise. Okay. Well,
yeah.
Okay. Wait.
So it's just vowel plus noise. So it's vowel.
But then, like...
Well, that's not an answer to the rule. Or, I'm missing...
That's the answer to the question, what is the antecedent?
Oh.
So this part...
Oh, okay. That's the part I am missing.
Oh, okay.
Okay,
yeah. Okay. Two manipulations
okay.
Here, right? One is just a query, this is just showing you doing binding, and this is now doing something,
okay.
A transformation.
I apologize to everybody else who has
okay.
Well,
hey,
I'm
wondering, actually, like... Yeah, the antecedent on the first equation is the anti, right? And then you calculate another antecedent, or like
here
on the second one.
Here.
Yeah.
No, all this is doing is asking what the antecedent is in this representation.
Okay.
So the answer here, this answer is equal to vowel approximately. It's equal to vowel.
So it's like vowel times one.
No, so when we multiply the inverse of antecedent times R, which is all that stuff, the result is going to be vowel.
Okay.
Just vowel plus noise.
Okay. Keep going now.
Okay. So if you, I don't want you to get lost in the math in a way, but you can trust me that it works. The point really is just to show you, like, so this is a very different way of thinking about how to do manipulations of symbolic structures, right? So if we write a Lisp program, then we don't think about doing manipulations of symbolic structures like this, right? We just write down what the manipulation, symbolic manipulation is. But if we're trying to do this with neurons, we have to think about it in terms that are consilient with using neurons to implement it, right? And representing high-dimensional vectors, we know is consilient with what neurons can do, and doing things like multiplication, nonlinear operations, given the neural engineering framework, is also something we know how to do. And what I'm showing you here is what the manipulations look like when you are trying to do it in a way consistent with neurons. So the math does work out. This is supposed to be an example that lets you show how to ask questions, how to unbind this thing. Right? Because the reason I give these examples, of course, is because if we perform this operation, what do we get? We get a big mush, right? We got a big mush, we have a vector that's the same dimensionality as everything else, and that might be useless. It's useless if we can't get the information out that we stuck in. So how do we get it out? This is how we get it out. Right? This is an example of how to get that information out that we stuck in. Well, then the other thing we want to do is actually change the information. Right? We might want to manipulate structure in any number of ways, other than just trying to get the information out. So this is showing you how we can change the information that's in there without actually having to take the whole thing apart and then re-encoding the whole thing. Okay? So this is something that turns out to be very powerful. Right? And it makes the neural circuits much simpler if we can perform these transformations without having to take everything apart and putting it back.
So the last part would be if you add the hypothesis as well implied even, and we realize it's incorrect, now we form it, you want to form a new hypothesis, a new potential rule that
exactly
consonant then even.
Right.
And that's how you
exactly it.
Okay.
Yeah, exactly right. So yeah, so this is basically saying, okay, I need to convert these two things. This is what you do. And if you bind this conversion with this rule, then the answer turns out to be exactly what you wanted. Right. So yeah, it's just trying to show you how to do the transformation. It's essentially a substitution, right? I want to change the value of this variable. How do I change the value of a variable? Actually, it's quite straightforward, right? You say what variable it is, and you say what you want the new value to be, right? That's all you've done.
I'm sorry?
Yeah?
I can see how you can represent one rule with one vector R, but suppose if you have multiple rules, how do you, you cannot add them together because they might, one rule might say one thing, the other might say something else about the constant.
So you could, I mean, there's multiple solutions to that, right? So you could actually have one vector representing more than one rule, right? You'd have to make it clear in the vector. So you could have a vector that stored two rules. You'd have rule number one, and then you'd multiply rule number one by all of this stuff. And then you add that to rule number two, multiply by all of rule number two, and you have one vector from which you'd have to, you could then, find the opposite of rule number two by the inverse and get it out. So you could do that. Or maybe it's the case that you actually have the rules represented in different parts of the brain, right? Different parts of the network. The solution is not determined here. But there's nothing in principle about the depth of structure that you can represent here. Right? Each of these vectors could be highly structured. Right?
And you don't have an entanglement at some point?
Yes. So I said in principle. Right? So in principle, there's no constraint. But yes, in fact, there is. And this relates to how many dimensions you have. Actually, I'll come back to that looking at the cleanup memory. Because that's, if you can't clean it up, then basically you can't, these operations would be useless. Okay. Okay, so that's the sort of high-level systems description, right? So that's actually the description of what are we going to replace sort of standard ways of doing structured representation with. Now, I've done it in terms of vector manipulation, but I haven't told you how neurons can do these sorts of vector manipulations. So what I'm going to do now is just very briefly try to give you a sense, not explain in detail, but give you a sense of how we can take a high-level vector description of a function, right? So things like binding and superposition and so on, and build a neural model which generates spikes and we can compare directly to the data that we can gather. So the first thing I want to do is introduce this notion of representation, because this is going to tie together the high-level system description and the low-level neural description. So the neural variables are going to represent those system-level. The neurons are going to represent those system-level descriptions, the high-dimensional vectors. So we start from the notion of a code. And for any code, if it's lossless, for instance, Morse code, you need to define two functions. You need to define an encoding and a decoding, right? So in case of Morse code, this is going to be something like the dots and dashes, and this is going to be, so A is a bunch of dots and dashes, and X is a bunch of letters in the Roman alphabet, and F is going to be telling you how to map those letters onto dots and dashes. So if this was SOS, right, this function would map it to Okay, so that's an encoding. We've gone from one kind of representation, one alphabet into another. So in terms of neurons, this is going to be our vector, and this is going to be neuron spikes, and this function F, right, is going to be how neurons respond to the changes in that vector. And so if you put, you know, for in the eye position case, the eyes are at one position, then you're going to get a bunch of spikes out in a certain pattern. If the eyes are at a different position, you're going to get a different pattern of spikes out. Okay, so it's the same sort of thing. It's an encoding. Now, decoding is different, right? So in the Morse code case, we know what the decoding is. It's exactly the opposite. So three dots means an S, three dashes means an O. So that gives us this inverse function where we can now start with dots and dashes and go directly back into what we started with, right? The code that we originally had. Now, in the case of neurons, this inverse isn't going to be perfect, right? There's going to be loss, there's going to be noise, and so on. And in fact, this is something that starts, that is all over the place. So as soon as you do any kind of analog to digital conversion, you run into the instance where you can't do a perfect reconstruction of the original signaling something, right? You don't have an infinite number of bits in your CD player to perfectly reproduce that. So instead of actually having this exact inverse function, we're going to have another function which is going to give us an estimate of x. So it's going to be an approximate inverse. But once we've identified these two functions, so this is a decoder of some kind and an encoder of some kind, then we will have an idea of what information can be represented. Okay, so in this case, we're going to have an idea of what information can be represented in neurons about a high-level vector, a high-dimensional vector. So this is what the encoding is going to tell us. And the decoding is going to say, yes, that information is in fact there, right? If we can get the information out, then it was there. If we can't, then it wasn't. So how does this look at neurons? So this is one of the two or three slides that I repeated between my two talks. Because this one is important for understanding the basic idea behind representation. So here we're going to think about just a very simple scalar representation. So again, eye position is my favorite example. So let's say the eye position is being represented by Bob and Alice. Right, that is, eye position is somehow driving these two neurons to spike. When this happens, you get a bunch of action potentials. They go down as an axon to a synapse. As the synapse are converted into neurotransmitters, those neurotransmitters go across the synaptic cleft and result in a postsynaptic current. And then that postsynaptic current goes into the neuron that they're connected to. And then if this goes over a threshold and so on, right, we get another bunch of spikes coming out, and the process continues. Now, the way that neuroscientists characterize the encoding, right, that is, the relationship between the activity of the cell and the variable that it's representing, is in terms of their tuning curves, right? So in this case, say Bob has a tuning curve where the activity of the cell goes down as the variable of interest goes up, okay? And so we'll talk about this particular encoding as being an encoding of -1, because it's like an off, right? It's flipped the increase-decrease relationship between x and the activity of the neuron. We can have another neuron which has +1, and it will have preserved that relationship. So it turns on when the variable gets larger. And so, in fact, when you look in the brain, you see all these kinds of different sorts of tuning curves. The tuning curves will have different slopes, they'll have different sorts of cutoffs, and so on. One thing that we can definitely see when we look at the tuning curves is they tend to be highly nonlinear, right? So here we've got an obvious nonlinearity where it just doesn't respond at all to this part. It's also nonlinear in time because you get spikes, right? You don't have a continuous value that's varying with x. You get spikes instead. And so this is sort of what neuroscientists have typically learned a lot about, right? How do the activities of neurons change when you change the stimulus that drives them? Okay, so all of that work we take to be encoding, right? It's trying to tell us something about the encoder and learning about the nonlinearities in neural encoding. But of course, we need two procedures, as I mentioned before. The encoding, which goes from stimulus to spikes, and the decoding, which takes us from those activities, those neuron activities, back to an estimate of the stimulus, right? If we don't define both of these things, we can't actually, as been said, to define representation. So here I want to give you a sense, briefly, of how we define this decoding. So now let's say, so x of t here, this is going to be I position, and we'll say that it's changing over time. Right? So we've got I position changing over time, so it's a scalar that changes as a function of time. We've got Alice, who's going to send spikes when we get changes that are highly positive. And we get Bob, that's going to send spikes when the changes are negative. And now the question is, well, what kind of decoding should we define here? And so our suggestion in the book is that, despite the fact that we've got a nonlinear encoding, the decoding can be linear. So what do we mean by linear? This is linear both over time and over the population of neurons. So by linear, what we mean is basically, you can look at the mechanisms that you see in neurons. And what you see is every time there's a spike, you get a postsynaptic current that occurs. Okay, so every time there's a spike, it's a postsynaptic current. And we're going to put down those postsynaptic currents for both Alice and Bob. So from Charlie's perspective, right, he's the receiving neuron. He's going to take a spike from Alice to indicate an increase in the value of our estimate, and a spike from Bob is going to indicate a decrease in the value of our estimate. Okay, so we've got two things going on here with decoding. One is the shape of this thing, which is decoding over time, and the other is whether it's positive or negative, right, which is telling us about the relationship between the information passed by Bob and Alice. Okay? Now, when I say it's linear decoding, what I mean is, after we have this function defined, all we're going to do is sum them up. Okay, so this is why it's a linear decoding, because all we've done is sum. So, and the reason we do that is because when you look in dendrites, in lots of cases, when you get spikes arriving at different times, the resulting postsynaptic current is the sum of the two postsynaptic currents that are produced when those spikes arrive individually. Right, so it's a biologically driven assumption. So when we sum them up, what we see is we get something that looks like an estimate of that original input signal. Okay, so this is our way of going from the high-level variable x, right, down to spikes, so what neurons actually do, and then back up to the high-level variable by getting an estimate of x. Yeah?
Do you have the exact function for the postsynaptic term?
Yep.
Yeah.
You don't have to, but we do. Okay. Yeah, we assume one. But it's an assumption that doesn't really matter. I mean, so you can model this as a diagonal system, too. And this decoding is the same.
How do you model it?
Have we model it?
Yeah.
We model it as a decaying exponential.
Okay.
Most of the time. Sometimes we have. But yeah, most of the time it's decaying. So, so this is the relationship that's really important because it tells us how to go from our high-level system description into neurons, right? And that's sort of what the purpose of the framework is. So what I want to emphasize about this first principle, so that this, I actually don't think I mentioned this, the neural engineering framework has three principles, one representation, one transformation, and one dynamics. And this is the first principle. That is that all neural representation is nonlinear encoding and linear postsynaptic current decoding. And I said optimal here because we can actually choose what the weights are, you know, whether this is positive or negative. We can choose that in an optimal way to give us the best estimate that we can get from a linear estimator. And so we're going to do that because there's no biology to constrain that choice. Okay, so I gave you an example with a simple scalar, but what I want to do is just sort of show you what that looks like when you move into a vector. So this is a movie in which we've got a high-level system variable up here, and we've got a neural population here. And what's going on is we're changing the high-level vector, right? So this is a 25-dimensional vector, it's a 5x5. And so as we change what the value of this high-level vector is, we can see how the neurons would represent that vector. And every time you see a yellow dot, there's a spike emitted. The gray and black dots are the postsynaptic currents rising, or not the postsynaptic currents, the somatic currents rising and falling. And so you can just see, basically, that there's a simple, or not a simple, there's a relationship of some kind between the high-level vector and the neural activity. And that relationship is going to be preserved regardless of where we are in this 25-dimensional space. So that this population of neurons can represent that entire space. Okay, so that sort of gives you a visual sense of what it means to be doing this in something other than a single scalar with a whole bunch of neurons. So they were all cooperating to represent that 25-dimensional space. Okay, so that's one thing. Number one was we had to represent high-dimensional vectors. Thing number two was that we have to perform nonlinear computation on those vectors. Right, so how are we going to do that? So at the high level again, right, what we're doing is we have a vector that is going to be encoded somehow, and manipulate it so that we get another vector which is equal to some other value. Which is very easy to state, but not so easy to implement. So if we call this box y and this box x, we want to enforce y equal to f of x, or f is some nonlinear function. So that's the high-level description, fairly straightforward. At the neuron level, of course, we want the same computation to be effective, right? So we want to be able to map this onto here, but we're going to have to do it by determining how to connect all of these weights together, right? So how do we set these weights such that the activities in this population are going to be reflected here, but having been transformed by the function f? Okay, so that's the sort of challenge we've set ourselves, right? We need to figure out what those weights are. And introducing the first rule, so this representation rule, will actually give us a good idea about how to pick these weights. So I'm just going to give you a quick example of that. Okay, so again, you know, it's always more complicated to write things in high-dimensional vector spaces, so I'm going to do it again for a scalar. But the principles are the same to move to high-dimensional vector space. So in this case, we've got an input going from negative 1 to 1 over time. So this is time. And this is going from negative 1 to 1. And we have a first population, which is representing the system variable x. And we have a second population, which is representing the system variable y, where y is going to be equal to x squared. Right? So the chosen function here is f of x being equal to x squared. So, of course, we are going to have a bunch of neurons, and they're going to have all their tuning properties. Right? So this is the different tuning curves for all these different neurons, and they'll look heterogeneous if they typically do in the brain. And then what we need to do is determine this omega ij. And conveniently, we can find decoders. So if you remember, I said that neural representation was optimal linear postsynaptic current decoding. But optimal decoders, which are going to give us an estimate of the originally input value x. We can actually do exactly the same thing for any function of x. And that's what this notation describes. So phi, these are our decoders for the function x squared. So, if we just took these and multiplied this by the activity coming out of A, we would be seeing if we could represent x squared using the activities that were generated by A. Right? So we got the input's driving all these cells, 100 different cells. And then the question is, can we, out of those 100 cells, get an estimate of the square of what the input was? And that's what this thing here would tell us directly. But of course, what we're really trying to do is connect neurons together, because we want the whole thing to operate in neurons. So what we do after we have that decoded value is project it into the tuning of these neurons, right? Mm-hmm. So some of these neurons like it when the value is up here, and then they turn off as it goes lower, and vice versa, and so on. So we have to project that decoded value of x squared into these particular neurons and make them fire in such a way that if we interpret those ones, we'll be able to see x squared. And if we do this, right, essentially all we're doing is multiplying the decoders times the encoders, we'll get a weight matrix that will actually tell us how to connect all of the neurons in A to all of the neurons in B to compute the function that we want. Right? And of course, we can change x squared to be whatever we want it to be. So we can perform the sort of ideal physiological experiment that nobody can do. We can stick an electrode in and record from all of our neurons at the same time. We can look at this, what the spiking activities are coming out of these neurons. And then we can say, well, is it actually computing the function that we want? So this is startup transient, but otherwise this would be the ideal quadratic function, giving an input that goes from negative 1 to 1. And then we can take these spikes and decode them and see what they're encoding, right? What is y equal to in this population of b? And the answer is something that is noisy, but is approximating the quadratic function, right? So it's approximating x, y equal to x squared. Okay, so what this tells us is that we can, in the scalar case, but again, we can generalize this to vectors, we can compute a set of weights which are going to enforce a transformation between A and B. Okay. So the nice thing about this is we haven't made any assumptions about the kind of nonlinearity we have, right? So any feed-forward nonlinearity will do, and we don't need learning, right? So I think there's lots of times when we want to introduce learning. Learning is great, but there's also reasons to avoid learning. Like trying to pick the order to show your learning, your training items in, trying to make sure that your rule is biologically plausible, so on and so forth. We can avoid all of those and analytically determine what these weights are to perform a function we think is being performed in the brain.
I'm sorry. Yeah. That goes only if you know the function you want to model. If you don't know, if you want to infer an unknown function from data, I guess you need learning. That's
So not necessarily, actually. So you can, well, it depends what you think about snoring. So you can turn this optimization into something that only deals with the samples you have.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So it can do the same sort of thing, but it does it globally, which is not biologically plausible, right? So it would biologically optimize these weights, or even globally optimize these weights, but that's not something that I would call learning because no neural system is doing this. Yeah.
When you solve the weights, do you discretize the function you want to? And if you do, like,
right,
you go from minus 1 to plus 1, where you go minus 1, minus 0.99.
So mathematically, it's just an integral. Yeah, but of course, when you write a math, when you write math out code, then yeah, this is but yeah, this is, yeah.
Well, I was just wondering, because you're fitting functions that go exactly for the point that you
yeah.
It's nice, but in between, but you're never guaranteed that the function will be as correct.
Right. Was so, that? Yeah, if you have an analytic form for the function, then it's not so bad, right? So, it's like, I mean, what we force you to do, well, not quite, but, I mean, if you have a hypothesis about what you think is being computed by the system, right, then these are weights that will guarantee you get that computation out. And that doesn't always happen with learning, right? And that's one of the big challenges of learning, is trying to make it do something that you want it to do. It doesn't always work. So, now that we know how to represent high-dimensional vectors, right, so this is the first principle, and then the second principle is transformation, perform nonlinear computations on representations. We can put these two things together and perform nonlinear computations on high-dimensional vectors. And of course, that's really what we want to do when we're saying we're multiplying A times B, right? I said this circular convolution is essentially a kind of multiplication. In fact, if you take a Fourier transform of it, it's exactly a multiplication. And so we can just write down this binding operation that we defined as being a piecewise multiplication, that's what this dot is, times the Fourier transform of two vectors. Conveniently, a Fourier transform is a linear operator, so that's actually very easy to implement in neurons. You can just set your weights so it implements the Fourier transform. And then the multiplication itself, you have to do by projecting out the product like we did before with x squared from representation of the two vectors. So this is a network that will perform this operation, and I don't expect you to understand the equations, but basically, if you generalize what I showed you before, we can determine what all of these weights are in order to perform the operation that we want to perform. Okay, so what does that look like? So this is now showing three populations of neurons, right? This is vector A, and this is vector B, and this is the convolution of A and B. Okay, so each of these looks just like before. They're representations of a 25-dimensional space, right, in neurons. So all the neurons are spiking to represent this pattern. These neurons are spiking to represent this pattern. And these neurons, now we've connected them together, right, using our analytic methods, such that we have the convolution of the original two input patterns. And as you can see, the convolution doesn't look especially like either the two input patterns. But of course, we can take that, decode it, and see if it is, in fact, equal to the convolution, and it is. Right, so this is now giving us a sense of how we can start constructing networks that are performing nonlinear operations on high-dimensional vectors. Right? Here, there are only 25 dimensions, but the principles are, of course, the same as you had more and more dimensions. Okay. So I began with four modeling challenges. Two of them were sort of intermingled, so I presented them at the same time. Right. The first was to come up with a way of having a structured representation that's in biologically realistic neurons. The second was, okay, once we have that, we know that we have to perform these nonlinear computations, so how can we do that? So I've shown you now simulations that do both of these things. The next thing I want to turn to fairly briefly is looking at a couple of the components that we might need in a cognitive architecture. And then last, I'll show you a circuit that we've built using these methods, one that, in fact, solves the Weissman selection. Now, before I do that, I want to address a sort of more conceptual issue, so that there's not going to be any math for a while, which may be a good thing. And the conceptual issue is, okay, we've got high-dimensional vectors, we're mapping them onto words, things like implication, vowel, consonant, and so on. But where do these vectors come from, right? What are they? Are they just as sort of unconnected to anything as a symbol would be? And I think that another benefit we sort of get from thinking hard about what neurons are doing in doing symbol processing is that no, in fact, those vectors are not disconnected. They're not disconnected from what the rest of the system is doing. And so we've posited this notion that I call a semantic pointer. And so a semantic pointer gives us a hypothesis about a particular architecture that's going to help us integrate these simple light objects, right? Obviously they're vectors, they're not exactly like symbols. So these simple light objects with perception, right? So that it's trying to ground those symbols in perceptual models. And I think this happens largely because we know how to build perceptual models using neurons. And this gives us a way of building cognitive symbol processing models using neurons. And they're basically both using neurons, so we can connect them in a conceptually reasonable way. So what are semantic pointers? So semantic pointers are basically vectors, right? Those vectors are special because they're compressed, which means they're much smaller than the thing they're pointing to, and they're content-based, which means that they carry the semantics. They carry something about the meaning of the thing that they are pointing towards. And they're acting like addresses, right? So this is why I'm calling them pointers, to information and association vortices. So presumably, this simple kind of manipulation that I've been talking about happens in frontal cortices and in language areas. But those vectors that are being processed in these areas point back to, right, so this is a computer science kind of notion, they point back to the information that is in association cortices, things that are typically more directly about perception.
Compressed means lower dimensional.
Compressed means lower dimensional, right, yeah. So there are pointers, right, because like a pointer in computer science, right, it's a small address that lets you pick out a whole bunch of information, right? So in computer science, it's just the address of a point in memory. And similarly, this vector can be used as something like an address to recall deep semantic information, right? So it can be taken, sent to perceptual cortices, and then filled out in terms of a perceptual model that you built up that gave rise to the pointer in the first place, okay? So it's like, in a way, it's exactly like a computer science pointer. In a way, it's not, because it's content-based, right? The relationship between an address and the thing it's pointing to in computer science is arbitrary. But here, the address itself is generated based on what it's pointing to, right? That's why it's a compressed version of it. So that's what preserves its semantics. So the reason it's semantic is because these pointers, which are compressed representations of perceptual information, themselves define a semantic space, right? I've called it a surface semantic space, because, of course, when you do this compression, you lose a lot of information. And so you only have some of the semantics captured in the pointers themselves. So this suggests, of course, that if we're doing superficial semantic processing, it can be done in language areas, because you've got these semantic pointers which have some semantics. But if the semantics becomes deep, right, you need to know something more detailed about this compressed representation. It's going to take longer because you have to go into your perceptual cortices, get the memory out, do the deep semantic processing, and send it back. So I want to try to spell that out just a slightly more detail using a visual example. So an example of where we might find a pointer for a visual semantic information would be looking at the activity in the top level of a standard model of object recognition. Okay, so this is a standard model of object recognition that you find all over the machine learning literature that people have attempted to map onto different parts of the brain. So over here, this is sort of a map of different cortical areas, particularly looking in the what pathway. So we've got V1, V2, V4, so on up to IT. So we've got the kinds of responses in the neural model that you've got. And what I'm suggesting is that all of this processing is leading to representations in anterior cortex, which are essentially compressed representations of all this previous information. So all we're going to do is take the activity of these neurons, not worrying about these, send it to frontal cortices, and then use that activity as our high-dimensional vector, right? That just is our high-dimensional vector, which we can then bind to other vectors and manipulate in a symbol-like way. Okay, so that pointer, that activity that we're just sort of stripping off the top of such a model, is the thing that we can now use like a symbol. But of course, it can also be used, it can be sent back here and act like a prior, right? So you get a vector from frontal areas, it comes back to the visual areas, and now it's a prior that's going to actually constrain top-down processing, through top-down processing, what the activity of all these cells are, and then you can basically give a sample which is consistent with this pointer. Right? So this is your dog symbol, it comes back, you constrain the activity of all these, which is essentially you imagining a dog, and now that dog gets particular properties, right? And so you could, you know, read off those properties for further processing. You didn't need semantic reasoning about this object. Okay, so this is the basic idea. Is there any reason to think it's a reasonable idea? The answer is yes. So essentially, the kind of timing that I suggested to you occurs when we actually see people doing semantic processing. So for instance, Solomon and Barsulu performed an experiment where they showed people pairs of words. So they'd show them a pair like dog card, or they'd show them another pair like banana monkey. And they'd say, is the second word a property of the first word? Right? So dog fuzzy, the answer would be yes. Dog card, the answer is no. Okay? But what they found is that if you do semantic processing where the semantics of the object are completely different, you actually respond to those about 100 milliseconds more quickly than if the semantics of the objects are related. Right? So banana is related to monkey, but monkey's not a property of banana. Right, so it's a much more subtly, semantically subtle distinction. And so, of course, on this sort of semantic pointer idea, this would require deep processing that actually goes to perceptual areas and fills in the details of what a banana is, what the properties of it are. This wouldn't take any time at all, because you can essentially take the dot product between these two things and see that it's pretty close to zero. So the answer is, these are not semantically related. If they're not semantically related, one is not the property of another. Furthermore, Candidal actually performed similar experiments using fMRI, and they actually see the precise change in activation that you'd expect. So you only get activation in the perceptual systems in the difficult cases, right? When you have semantics that are similar between the two words, right? Regardless of it, of whether or not it's actually a property or not, you'll get activity in the perceptual areas, right? So you basically see parts of the parietal cortex light up. So this suggests that not only is there a speed cost, but in fact the processing occurs in a different part of the brain, which is consistent with the semantic pointer hypothesis. And finally, it also is the case that you don't see those light up in the easy circumstances, right? So that means we can do semantic processing without using perceptual systems, right? In these cases, only frontal areas light up, but only if a simple lexically based strategy is going to actually help you solve the task, right? So if you just do really rapid comparisons, which don't depend on deep semantics, you can do that processing simply in frontal cortices, namely the parts that are employing the shallow semantics of these semantic pointers. Okay, so that's a sort of a bit of an aside as far as trying to construct a cognitive system, but I think it's important because it really tells us how we can integrate this sort of cognitive view that we're going through a lot of pain to construct, right? We have to come up with neurons, and we have to figure out how to do non-linear processing with them, and we have to have high-dimensional spaces. Well, why did we do that? Not only for the reasons I mentioned before, but also because it's actually going to be very integrative. It can help us integrate our specific perceptual models, which are, there are actually quite a lot of when you look at neuroscience or theoretical neuroscience type of models, with cognitive models, right, which there aren't very many of. But if we have this way of integrating the two, I think it's really going to help tell a unified story about how cognition works. Okay, so with that in mind, I want to now just turn briefly to the two components that I mentioned, and then finish up showing you how to solve the Weisenkarn task. So I'm going to do these really quickly, and the reason I picked this particular example, a buffer, is because, as I mentioned before, this is something you see in almost every single cognitive model out there right now. And a buffer is simply a kind of working memory that can be updated. Right, so here's a simple diagram. This is the thing that's going to be the buffer. This buffer has to store the current context information. These parts of the brain are looking at that current context information and determining if their rule applies to that context. If it does, then that buffer will be changed according to this rule. And if it doesn't, then nothing will happen. Okay. And so this is sort of a kind of architecture that will let us do that in a neurally possible sort of. Now, I don't want to talk in detail about the architecture itself, but there's a couple of points to make about such a component. One is that we can actually take out a buffer from a standard production rule kind of cognitive model and replace it with a model like this. Right? So since we know how to encode and decode rules sort of between symbol-like representations and neural-like representations, we can actually begin to replace parts of models that are not neural with neural components. Second, If we notice that most of these buffers are actually mapped to the basal ganglia, right? So this is sort of an internal part of the brain, it's subcortical. And we also know that, in fact, basal ganglia is dominated by a particular kind of receptor called GABA-A. This is an inhibitory receptor. And these have a time constant of 10 milliseconds. This actually gives us a very particular prediction about how long we think it's going to take for one of these rules to affect this buffer. Okay, so we now have brought neural constraints into our model, right? The constraint is that GABA-A is the kind of neurotransmitter that's used here, and that is going to mean that the time constant has to be 10 milliseconds.
How is the mapping?
Sorry?
How is the mapping?
The mapping between what?
To
the basal ganglia?
Yes.
So typically, it's just the basal ganglia itself is seen as something that compares items that are in working memory around different parts of cortices, so they have visual working memory, auditory, and so on. And the basal ganglia sits there, looks at the contents of those, and then updates the buffer based on whether or not a rule is applicable. And it's not mapped any more specifically than that. So you mean, like, is it mapped to, like, different cortical structures?
Yes.
Yeah, no, it's typically not that. Okay, so this is basically saying, okay, if we implement that sort of architecture using the NEF method, what happens? And so here we can say we've started off the buffer, we've got a bunch of neurons that are spiking, and we can see that P1, so we've got five rules down here. P1 says, oh yeah, that's the beginning of a rule I like, so I'm going to change it. What I'm going to change it to is the beginning of what P2 likes. So now it's changed it, and then P2 says, hey, that's the thing that I like in a buffer, so I'm going to apply my rule. My rule is change it to the thing that P3 likes, right? So now change it to P3, and so on. So what we're going to see is that basically each of these rules is firing in turn, because we've set it up so the rules are chained, right? So they're just going to keep chaining around and around. So this shows that we can have a buffer, we can have a working memory that is going to be stable over time, and it can be changed, it can be updated depending on what the current rule is. But the thing that's interesting is that when we introduce this constraint of using GABA as the kind of neurotransmitter that's connecting the rules to buffers, we find that the average length of time that it takes to change from one rule to the other is in fact 46.6 milliseconds, right? That's the precise time. But that matches surprisingly well with the 50 millisecond assumption that's been made in general by cognitive modelers, right? So now we have an answer to the question, why does it take 50 milliseconds? The answer is because, or one potential answer is, of course, is because the basal ganglia is the part of the brain that's doing the rule matching, and it's neurotransmitters have a time constant of 10 milliseconds. So now we've been able to give an explanation for something that was an assumption in cognitive modeling before. The other component is this cleanup memory, right? So I've been asked a couple times, well, how do you, you know, when you have an approximate representation, how are you going to make sure that you know it's the right one, or what amount of information are you losing, or you're not going to be able to have arbitrarily complicated representation? So the answer is yes. So in order to perform that simple lexical processing, right, that is the surface processing that we're doing with our semantic pointers, we have to ensure that the result of the processing is a valid semantic pointer, right? We have to interpret our result, because our result will always be noisy. So this is saying exactly that. The vector solver we chose is doing compression, so the output is not identical to any valid answer, and so we need to make sure that we clean up the results. So we're going to need something that people call a cleanup memory. It's basically a simple association memory. And standard solutions to this problem, this is a common problem, are things like the Hopfield network and other cloud-associated memories. And basically what you're doing is you have a complex, non-linear, high-dimensional function that's going from noisy inputs to clean outputs. Right, so there's going to be a group of vectors, all of which look enough like the dog vector, that we're going to say that is the dog vector. So what it's doing is taking this noisy group and outputting exactly the dog vector. And we need to be able to do that in order to make sure that our processing continues on without getting lost, right? Or that we actually have confidence in the answers that we're generating. So all I'm going to show here is a comparison between one standard solution, which is backpropagation. So if we take a network and we try to learn that function, that complex function, using backpropagation, we find the following results. So each of these is telling us how many objects, how many vectors we put together. Okay, so this is when we add two vectors together and we try to clean them both up. This is when we added 4, 6, and 8, right? So different numbers of vectors. And M is the number of items in memory, right? So if we only have two vectors that are added together, and we only have 10 items in memory, if our vector space, the whole thing, each vector is only, or is 20 dimensional, we'll easily clean it up, right? So we're guaranteed that 90% of the time we get the right answer, or over 90% of the time. That's how we read these graphs. At the same point, if we have four items in memory, then we're still on this side of 90, but 90 is getting closer. Here, now it's less than 90, somewhere between the two, and here we're beginning to lose it. Okay? And as we increase the number of items in memory, we see that we get worse and worse, so we're going to start confusing things. But as we increase the number of dimensions, we actually get better and better. So if we have a 500-dimensional vector, and there's 20 items in memory, we can still tell them all apart with a lot of confidence. Okay, this is what this is telling us. But now, the thing to notice, of course, is that 500 isn't a lot. Right, so the vocabulary of a six-year-old child is on the order of 10,000 items. So here, we've actually shown the NEF model that we do. And here it's important to point out that we can actually begin to scale up to this kind of size. Right, so if we have 500-dimensional vector in our vector space, and we have six items that are encoded, we can encode about 5,000 to 10,000 items with a confidence of about 90%. Okay, so this means that we're getting into the realm where we can actually make claims that we're going to be able to do vector processing on the scale of a six-year-old or something, right? A budding cognitive system. And of course, as we increase this dimensionality, then we can see what the trend is here, right? We're going to exponentially increase the number of things we can store and still be able to decode it.
So what magical Miller number does this predict?
Sorry?
What would this predict that Miller's magical number would be?
Miller's magical number. That's an issue about working memory. This is not a working memory system. This is a system which is just doing associative memory with things that have already been well learned. So it's not working memory. This is sort of permanent long-term memory. So this is the entire lexicon of the six-year-old. Right, and we're saying, if a six-year-old has two items that they're trying to represent at the same time, can they tell them apart? And the answer is, well, as long as the dimensionality of the space they're represented is whatever, 100 or greater, they'll have no problem.
I don't think Miller's magical number is just for working memory. The working memory example was digit span, the length of digits, but there's also simply how many absolute discriminations you can make, and that's not working memory.
How many absolute discriminations
you can make? Along a dimension. How many chunks you can divide it up into and still tell them apart reliably?
Yeah, so and that has a lot to do with what your chunking processes are and how familiar you are with the chunked environment, right? So what you're chunking it into. They have the examples where the people who remember the running times really well, so they take all the numbers and turn them into running times and so on. So this is not a functional model. So it's not trying to predict a particular function. It's just saying, with these kinds of representations, right, can we tell that many items apart? And it's not going to make a prediction about a particular number, because as we increase the number of dimensions, right, we can put more and more and more stuff in.
Which is exactly what Miller said. Increase the number.
So the relationship is exponential. So depending on how many dimensions you have, you will have an exponential increase in the number of items you can distinguish. So if you told me, so I don't think this is the case, but if Miller had the number, right, of items you could possibly fit in a memory, I would be able to make a good, I'd love to do this, and they'd be able to make a guess of what the dimensionality of the system is. Yeah. But right now, as far as I know, the only kinds of constraints I've been able to find are things like, what is the lexical size of adults? And so it goes up to about 100,000 items. And so that means that we're probably needing on the order of 700 to 1,000 dimensions in our vectors. But the nice thing is that we can begin to look at these sorts of trade-offs, right? And that kind of psychological data is exactly what we want in order to try to do a job of constraining these cognitive models.
Fuzzy my mind with K represents, like
K.
The child knows that 10,000 is a lexical item, is K? You tend to decide whether I said banana or orange.
K is the, so if you say, there's a banana and an orange, right? The child has to generate a representation which has both banana and orange in it. And this tells you how many items you could put together in order to, that the If I could tell
banana from orange, that would be a case of K equals true. If I have to tell banana from apple and orange, it would be a case of K equals true.
In the representation that you're currently presented with, yes. Right. So, yeah. So if it was, okay, you've got a banana, an orange, and this and that. I mean, they're then going to start running into working memory issues, right? Except for the fact that you can chunk stuff in working memory and so on. But yeah, this tells you basically how many different items could be in that representation that you can then pull apart and know that you're going to get a lexical item that's valid. So, I mean, it's a real question what K is.
So
maybe this is maybe more
of a question. Is the sample of K out of the 10,000, say, or
right.
10,000.
Yeah, so you randomly pick 8 items, you add them together, and then you say to the system, can you tell me what the 8 items are?
Okay.
Right? And so, you know, if you have a 5 to 100 dimensional vector, then you are 80% sure that you get them all.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
that makes sense.
That makes a lot clearer.
Okay, so back to the modeling challenges, right? We've done each of these 3 things, so I've shown you a couple of vector components. And the last thing I want to do, again, quickly, is just talk about the wasted card task, because this is the case that we've actually done in some detail. So this is the task, as I mentioned before, where you're shown 4 cards, and you're told there's a number on one side, a letter on one side and a number on the other, right? So there'd be letters on the back of this and numbers on the back of this. And then you're told that, here's a rule. Tell me which cards you have to turn over in order to verify that rule. And the rule is, if there's a vowel on one side, and there's an even number on the other, right? That rule should look familiar. So that's the kind of rule that we coded it for. When you show this to people, they are very bad at this test, right? Everybody turns this card over, but most people forget to turn this card over, right? And if there is a consonant on the other side, or if there's a vowel on the other side of that card, right, then the rule has been violated. So this, if you don't turn this rule over, or this card over, you don't know whether that rule is true with these cards or not. Okay, so the best number I found when people present this is about 30% of participants will get it correct, right? So it's fairly low, and the numbers go down to like 10% or less, depending on the particular study. Now, if you do something that is logically isomorphic, right? So this is exactly the same logical problem, but you've changed the instructions, or you've changed the content, right? So here, we're saying, if someone is drinking alcohol, then they have to be over 21, pretending in this case, right? They have to be over 21. And now you ask participants, of course the participants are college graduates, right? Which means this is very salient to them, trying to figure out when they're gonna be violating this rule or not. 90% of the people will tell you have to turn over the beer card and the 16 card, right? Everyone checks the back of this card, even though it doesn't really match the rule in any obvious way, right? It's a violation of the rule. So there's been a lot of ink spilled over exactly why this happens. But in any case, we came up with a simple hypothesis which essentially says, well, what people do is they learn from past experience, and if they think they're in a context that is consistent with that experience, they'll apply the logical reasoning that is appropriate to that past experience. Right, so basically, people learn how to reason in different ways under different circumstances. That's what our model results in. So now we need to implement this model. So we're going to represent the rule, right? So that's exactly what I showed you before, represent the rule. We're going to have some context information. So this can come from ventromedial prefrontal cortex. So this is going to say, you know, I'm in a social context where I'm drinking, or I'm in a context that's unfamiliar and people are talking about vowels and consonants, so I don't really assume much. And then when people have done scans while this task is being performed, and you see a lot of activity in right inferior frontal cortex, so we're going to say that's where the main processing occurs. And what's going to happen here is the context signal is going to drive an associative memory, which says, in this context, what is the right way of reasoning, right? So this is determining some transformation, which is going to then operate on this rule, okay? So that transformation will determine a response based on the current rule that's available. That response will go up to motor areas, or people say things, return over stuff. And then, of course, it will also be compared to what the correct answer is. So you have to be able to update your associative memory in case you're wrong, right? And you'll do that. So this is sort of what the model looks like. So we implemented this model using exactly the operations I've introduced so far, except for I haven't told you about how to do learning, but we do learning as well. So here you've got rules. These rules are being transformed by some other vector, right? And so this is just basically doing your convolution. And then you're doing a comparison here. You're trying to figure out if the response is good or not, and you can do another convolution to determine that. And then you're using that to drive updating of your associative. So that's sort of a high-level view, and it took about 20,000 neurons to implement this. And now we can see, well, how does the system work? And we're going to start by turning the learning on and putting ourselves in the abstract context. So that's the context where we have vowels and numbers. And we're going to say to the model, okay, when you're in this context, the appropriate response is going to be vowel and even. And the reason that's appropriate is because we're going to interpret it as an if and only if rule. And now the reason we think that's done is because if you say to a child, for instance, if you eat your peas, then you'll get some ice cream, you do not mean this as a material conditional. Right? You mean that if you eat your peas, you'll get ice cream, and if you got ice cream, you must have eaten your peas. You're not going to get ice cream if you don't eat your peas. Right? That's what that rule means. So the word if, then, right, I think, is interpreted, if we don't have another interpretation, the default interpretation will be that you are violating that rule if the consequent is actually not satisfied. Right? Even though that's not what is meant in this particular case of a material conditional when you're, for instance, drinking alcohol. So there's some subtleties to basically the way people are mapping language onto logic, right? That has been missed to some extent by people doing these sorts of tasks. In any case, I mean, we can talk about that story more if you want to or not, but in any case, that's why we would say, oh, this is the appropriate kind of learning, right? This is eating your peas, ice cream kind of context, because that's our default. But of course, now when we get the antecedent with the consequent, and then you say, oh, you're in a social context now, what do you do? And you say, oh, well, I'm going to look at the case that violates this, the antecedent, or rather, violates the consequent, and also look at the antecedent. So this is just saying, look, we built a model that reproduces the results that are already known. So that's not so interesting. I mean, to some extent, it's interesting because we can actually go and say, well, here's all the spikes, right? This model is working with neurons that spike, and we've connected them in such a way that they're doing language processing, and they've done learning of language processing in a context, and so on, right? So it's kind of interesting. But you can also be a little bit skeptical about whether it's cognitive, because all it's really doing is reproduce what we told it to do, right? It learned some mapping and reproduce the mapping. That's not interesting. But in fact, it's learned more than that. And we can see that from this result. So here we're doing the same sort of thing, but what we're doing instead is we're leaving the context the same, right? So we're saying, okay, you're in a social context, and what I'm going to do is provide you with some examples of how to reason in social contexts. So I provide one example where, in this social context, you're going to be voting, right? So here you have to turn over not over 18, because people over 18 can't vote. And here's the drinking case, right? Okay, those people can't drink. And now you're in the same context, and I'm giving you a brand new rule you've never seen before, but you know what context you're in, it's a social context. How do you reason? So here, the case is, the rule is, if you're driving, then you can't be over 16, right? Or what is the way I phrased it before? If you're driving, then you're under 16. How do you reason in that context, right? And what is nice here is that we get the answers, not over 16 and drive, right? And what that means is, the system has generalized from two past examples based on the syntax of the rule, right? So the content has changed, but the syntax stayed the same, and what it did was generalize syntax. And there are a large number of psychologists who claim that syntactic generalization is really the hallmark of cognition, right? That is the ability to essentially ignore content when you can use that, the structure of the rule, the structure of the reasoning environment, to give you a good answer in this circumstance. And you can see that's exactly what the model has done here. Okay, so this, I would be much more willing to defend as something that really looks like a cognitive behavior, where it's the syntax that's driving the reasoning, not the semantics. Okay? And this is largely what people like Fodor and so on mean by things like systematicity. Right? Is there's a systematic relationship between these things, and that systematic relationship is structural. It's not context-sensitive, or content-sensitive. Okay. So that was sort of the model in which we put a whole bunch of these parts together. And the conclusions I want to draw are the following. The first is that cognitive modeling using spiking neurons is viable, right? So this was something that a lot of people questioned at all, right? Why bother with neurons? You shouldn't do it. It's too complicated. And when you do it, it's not going to look cognitive. But I think that that's definitely not true, given this, the last model I showed there. The other is that we can actually build these models in a systematic way. Right? If we understand the principles of the NEF and we adopt a vector symbolic architecture, we can now go and build a whole ton of models, all of which are going to be able to do language-like processing, things which can learn to be content insensitive, and so on, or get a lot of these cognitive effects. It's actually informative, so building these models tells us things about the system that we didn't know before. Like, why does it take 50 milliseconds? Why does it take 50 milliseconds for a rule to fire? Right? Why is that a reasonable number that's going to actually predict all this reaction time stuff? So that's a particular example. It's also informative about other things, what parts of the brain are active during different kinds of tasks and so on. So we can learn things by adopting a neural view. It's more constrained, right? So we can bring in constraints about what kinds of neurotransmitters are being used, what are the tuning curves of neurons, what are the anatomical connections that are actually available for doing processing and so on. And lastly, I think it can also be ground, right? So this kind of model fits very naturally with all of the kinds of processing that we see from visual models and auditory models that have been generated by lots of theoretical neuroscientists. Okay, so on that note, I will stop.